Hello. My name is Christopher Maynard Bubbs, and about 30 years ago, when Dave and I were hanging out, we kicked in the back door of the National as we were expanding our minds. And we were amazed that this great, glorious city had left such a treasure to rot. And never in my wildest imagination did I think that 30 years later I would be here talking about my dear friend. And it is my task that I'm so honored to have known him. And I debated for the last week trying to do this man justice who meant so much to all of us. I mean, how do you define David Brockett? There's a million definitions, and all of them are true. And as sure as I am that all of us can relate, in the parade of memories and emotions that have engulfed us since his passing, he lived a life worthy of a million stories. Not all of them can and should be told today. Because it would be a four-day memorial, and we still wouldn't get to them all. But the one thing that binds them all together is that all of them are true. There is not a single word in the fucking English language that does not accurately describe Dave Brockie, and at the same time, is frankly incapable of conveying the true meaning and depth of who he was. Having thought about him and who he was this past week, I keep coming back to one thing. Dave Brockie. David Murray Brockie was a human being. And what a gloriously wonderful, bouncing ball of bright light that motherfucker was. Oh my God, it was like when he was excited, he was bursting. You couldn't help but be sort of like high off of him. Oh my God! Yes, Dave, let's kill everything, yes! I'm behind you, whatever, so let's go fucking kill it all! And my friend David Brockie. And nobody I have known has embodied what it means to be a human being more than him. Every emotion, every inspiration, every passion, he milked to its full zenith. With every fiber of being, he lived. Knowing him made me want to be a better person. Knowing him, you laugh. Go ahead and laugh. Get it out. But it is true. And through him I learned that life is first and foremost a participation sport. I learned to always question authority. I learned the meaning of active engagement, commitment, and work. I learned to grab life by its big, nasty, syphilitic cock and suck that motherfucker and don't give me what I wanted! Want to be a better person. And was he perfect? Fuck no! He was a fucking asshole. And like everything he did, if he was the asshole, he was the biggest, loudest asshole there ever was. Lord, shit, what an evil motherfucker he could be. But that's what I love most about him. He was amazingly imperfect. He lived life with his heart on his sleeve. He let his emotions flow through him without restriction. Sometimes those emotions took him to strange, uncharted territory that even himself was incapable of understanding. But no matter how cruel and insensitive he could be, you always knew that was his fucked up way of proving that he cared about you. And you never had to doubt if he cared. And that was a big part of who Dave was. Sometimes you had to do battle with him. I engaged in so many battles and useless squabbles with him. But if you're a friend with Dave, that's what he wanted from you. He wanted conflict. Inspire me. Tell me I'm wrong. Tell me I'm right. He wanted stuff from you. And the great thing about Dave, there was never a dull moment. Because you never knew which Dave you were going to get. Could it be the Dave, the tender, compassionate patron of all that's good and decent? Or could he be evil Dave? The Dave that broke you down in a couple of words just to give him some mild amusement. But no matter what Dave I got, I loved all equally. I love them all because they were all infinitely fascinating, intelligent, hilarious, and real. It's been said that you can judge a man by the lives he touched. And in this case, and in this motley crew, he lived life well. I am honored, humbled, and eternally grateful to call many of you my friends. Looking around this room, Dave will never die because I see him in all of you as I hope you see him in me. Two of my Guar brothers, Scott Crawl, Michael Bishop, Bobby Gorman, you know who you are, Don Drakovich. I am so honored to be mentioned in your presence, or that you allowed me to memorialize Dave. It really is an unbelievable honor. And I'm amazed by your collective and individual compliments. In fact, I don't think there's a person in this room that doesn't take a measure of pride in what you've achieved over the last 3 decades. When someone finds out that I, yes, am the original ball sack, which I never thought would be my fate. I was supposed to be a great artist that was playing music, you know, hey man, that would be serious. I'm serious about my shit. But what do they know me for? They would love this as a bit player in the story of David Brock. Just as he told me I would end up. But I'm always quick to tell them that the band only got better after I left, and I had precious, precious little to do with the success they achieved. And to know you guys is truly an honor, and you will forever have my unyielding dedication, loyalty, and respect. And my life has only been made better by knowing you guys. Thank you so much. And as the days, weeks, months, years pass, and we all go back to our lives, and we don't have that loud beacon of all things cheering us, condemning us, the thing I think is most important to take from this, from his passing, is that we should never forget that our best days are in front of us. I know that sounds like bullshit. Doesn't it? Sounds like the best days are in front of us. My life sucks. But it is true. I don't even believe it, but I tell myself that. I tell myself that because I knew Dave Brock. Sure, he could be morose, he could be many things, but the one thing he wasn't, he was not a fucking quitter. And I deal with so many fucking lame ass dickheads.
Well, we only get a half, price beer tonight. Let me set up my chart here.
And I think about the passion and dedication that he possessed and instilled in me to do things. I should just masturbate, but then my wife said, but it is true. The best dicks are in front of us. And it'll be hard to comprehend as memories fade, life gets complicated. But as sad as and distraught as we are today, we need to take from his life his unbelievable zest for living and to apply it to our own lives and make this world a more interesting place to live in. And that's what he did. He did like a saint. He was a patron saint to all of you, all the people I know, the band, you know me. I heard him love all of you. So here's to you, Dave. Thank you for making my and all of our lives more interesting, funny, and enjoyable. Thank you for your amazing wit, your insatiable intellect, your boundless compassion, but most of all, thank you, David Brocky, for being my friend.
Man. Boobs, good God. My name is Michael Bishop. Yes. April Fools! Fuck. Oh, yeah. I'm the original Beef King of Mighty. I played in Gwar with Dave starting the summer before my senior year in high school, back in 1987 to around 1994. And, you know, we eventually went in different directions. I always counted Dave Brocky among my dearest friends, and I loved him very much. And I too never thought that I would be standing here doing this. Because he was just a life force. I mean, Chris, you know, I almost don't even need to stand up here. That was so awesome, capturing what Dave was. And Dave, to me, was possibility, man. Like, this whole town, Richmond, looking at this place from Hopewell, Virginia. Like, you know, I talked with Dave a lot about death because he was the sort of guy who would talk about death. Like, you could talk about things like that with him. And we talked about mortality, about belief, about the future. But ever since I came to know him, I've been unable to imagine a world without Dave Brocky. And the good thing is that I don't have to. He was central to my knowledge and experience of the world, as he has been to so many people here today. And none of us, we don't have to imagine a world without him because we had him. We had him. And for that, oh my God, what a gift that is. We had him. And the world will never be without him again. Ever. None of us will. And that's what matters. In those early days on the Gwar school bus, man, you know, I want to talk to that. I want to speak to that, to my friends, man, puttering through the Mojave Desert. Fighting over crackers at a maximum speed of 45 miles per hour. Passing the corpses of cows. And Dave and Chuck Barker, I remember distinctly him coming when we drove from Louisiana and we got to Texas. None of us have been to fucking Texas. And we get, he's like, there's cowboys out there. They were real cowboys on a horse and everything. You know, we were all such fucking bumpkins and geeks. Geeks, man. That's what we did. We played Dungeons and Dragons. Dave Bracken. So many times I've thought to myself, my God, what kid wouldn't give his left nut to have Dave Brocky as a dungeon master? And we talked about putting it in the obituary under the things he was. Dave Brocky, comma, dungeon master. You know, and to drive the bus, you were Captain Kirk. That's what geeks we were. And it became a verb, Kirking. Driving was Kirking. And every Kirk needed a Sulu. Someone to navigate or to talk to just to keep them awake. And, you know, Suluing, it was all a verb. So I was oftentimes Brocky's Sulu. And I didn't even drive. I mean, I didn't have a driver's license. But we were just such unbelievable nerds, man. I mean, that, and Brocky, what I remember about that night, you know, and it's crazy because everybody who was on that bus, so many of them, they're here right now. Almost everybody. They're here right now on that bus that night that we're hurtling through and sweating and stinking. And I can still hear Brocky in the darkness looking out at the highway coming straight for us, singing Springsteen, Nebraska. The whole fucking album. The whole thing. In that a cappella, booming, utterly unselfconscious baritone. Through the Badlands, above me. And we're trying to sleep. You know, we're crying because we lost it, but we goddamn got it. We got it. We got that. Scott Crawl, we got that, buddy. God. Fuck, we got it. And, you know, those moments, those questions, like, you know, we talked about everything, but what we did on the bus, what I remember about the bus is dreaming and scheming about what we were going to do. And the people who are here today, you know, you know what I'm talking about. I've tried to explain this again and again. I've never been able to explain it to anybody. That, you know, that sense of possibility that anything was possible. And after a show, we're hurtling through the night, and all we needed to do was think of it. I've seen in articles Dave tries to describe this. I've read him struggling with it. Spitballing, he called it. Holding up a mirror. A funhouse mirror to the world. And I guess that's right, you know, just throwing out ideas. And the craziest thing of all was that they came true because of the people here in this room. They came true. He, you know, yes, let's have a giant ass that shoots out oatmeal turds. Do it. It's a green light. Shit up. And I'm an academic now. I have to try to explain to people this shit. Can't do that. I gave up. One look. I live in fear of the day that they just read one fucking, the lyrics to one song. I'm fired. So, you know. Showed me through example that whatever I wanted to be, it was in my power to realize it. That's what Dave showed. And he was our leader. There is no question of that. He was our leader. And he was a very good one. He did it under duress, and the good times and the bad. He was a you know, it sounds so trite to say it, but it's just true what he's saying, that what Chris was saying. He was a motivator of men. And he saved me. You know, that's what I'm trying to say, is that he taught me that I was, it's not that I had this chance, it's that I was obligated to realize my potential. That it was my duty, that it was expected of me. And he, you know, man, that's the kind of thing you say about a fucking drill sergeant at a military school, you know?
Well, he made a man out of me.
But you know, he fucking did. And he did it fun. You don't notice when you're being made a man of by a clown like that. You don't notice it. So, you know, to me, I remember distinctly him saying, like, you know,
so did you graduate? This summer, your ass is mine.
And, you know, Brocky, he was a big deal to me. I mean, coming from where I came from, this fat, tearful, little, aspiring punk rocker and bass player and Hopewell, all I had was hope, just desire. And I needed direction. And you know, Dave's band, that's the other thing I want people to understand, that, you know, I mean, things were different. Information was different. Death Piggy, to me, I recognized it the moment I saw it. I saw something that I could relate to, something that I could have, that I could do. I saw a way out. In my particular punk rock conversion narrative, Death Piggy and Dave Brocky himself, they were huge. I mean, those names, it's not like I made any distinction between Black Flag, Circle Jerks, Dead Kennedys, Death Piggy. You know, it was all the same to me. I mean, and the sound of that music, it sounded like anything was permissible, like rules were suspended. And, you know, I want to talk about music just for a minute because, and Dave's contribution, right? His mastery of the absurd. Even then, he in Death Piggy, he was building a sort of world, and it sounded like a world that I wanted to live in. Bathtubs in space, boners, whipping around the bed, you know, and hope, I mean, it all just seemed like, you know, beyond me from this mysterious world outside of my life. And when I got a chance to join it, I'll never forget it, how I stood with Dave right over here, right down here, man, at that point where there's a place in the triangle right by the dairy where there's like this weird triangle street. And I just remember this feeling washing over me that my life was never going to be the same again. And the guy who was next to me was Dave Brocky, you know? Here's a terrifying fact, you know? I learned to be a person from Dave Brocky, from being born. And from all of these guys. These are my brothers, my sisters. And Dave could be a parent. He was a guardian of sorts. He protected me. He protected me from things people were doing. He protected me from Fat Lawrence, who used to run the Marvins. Remember that dude? Yeah, he tackled Fat Larry. He tackled him because he was hassling me. And he was like, he is 17 years old. A man of contradictions, you know, the truth that Chris was saying, like, it's just, you just had to give up trying to understand him and just take him, take the world as he did, as one long, absurd, crazy, terrifying, hilarious joke. And you know, this is a guy who's saying, no more homo butt chain, or you'll get AIDS. Who created AIDS beer. He made sure that inappropriate, offensive references permeated every single thing that Guar created. Thus, creating a masterpiece of obscenity. And yet Dave loved his brother Andrew fiercely. And I remember that. I remember seeing, I almost didn't understand it. You know, he would become like a kid around Andrew, and the tenderness with which he spoke of this guy, how clearly they loved him. And when Andrew succumbed to AIDS, it hurt him. And he was creating about that. That's what he was doing. You know, he got a bunch of, a room full of metalhead kids to sing with him, "I'm gay and I'm proud." No, he did that, man. He did that in 1992. Not now. The Funhouse Mirror, man. You know, in a time when people were ignoring that disease, characterizing it as a gay thing, Dave Brocky was talking about it. Gore was talking about it. And we did it our way, in a way that might have ruffled some feathers, but we did it. And, I'm so proud, man, all the time of that. I'm proud of all of it. What's that? Oh, yeah, man. You know, I said, and I will say here again, that Dave Brocky, the musician, the lyricist, the lead singer, he is seriously underrated. And I will go so far as to say that I have never seen a more vibrant, energetic, and quick-witted performer on stage. Vaudeville, Groucho Marx to heavy metal. That intellect, man, and lyrically, true poetry. True poetry, you know, and he hated fucking poetry. Hated it. But he wrote it, man. And he wrote it, you know, I mean, now, like, years later, you know, I mean, people are, you know, there's a whole, like, movement of, like, you know, well, maybe poetry shouldn't be, like, fucking navel-gazing bullshit. And, you know, he was doing that. And, you know, his voice, you know, he was a first-rate poet. And, like I said, a past master of obscenity. And he used that to create meaning. He wrote so clearly and sang so passionately. His voice, just so utterly unique. He brought to heavy metal music true poetry, true depth of feeling, and a broad knowledge, a very far-ranging intellect about history, about art. I can say, and this is, he was a genius. He really was. He was a genius. Voice, which is just, I mean, I can't replicate it, like, you know, but when we went to the Grammys the first time, I remember that we saw it the first time. So many, I don't even remember what year it was. We saw Patrick Stewart in the Shriners Auditorium. We were in costume, Patrick Stewart. It was up on a balcony like this, looking out over, and you know, I mean, it's LA, right? You know, you see famous people, and everybody's like, oh yeah, yeah, that's Madonna. No, she's always here, it's cool. Rocky. Jean-Luc Picard! As I live and breathe! And what he said, you know, what this guy said, like, he laughed out loud. You know, he's like, and he goes, "Someone should do Shakespeare." That's quite a baritone. And then Brocky starts fending through the crowd. You know, he's trying to get to him, but Stewart's like, absolutely no way he's going to talk to that big rubber monster. I want to talk just a minute in conclusion about, and Chris, man, I mean, Dave's generosity of spirit. He made things possible for other artists in this city. He didn't have to do that. He didn't have to let bands rehearse for cheap. He didn't have to reach out to other artists to acknowledge them like he did. He gave so many people a sense that what they were doing was worth a shit, man. I mean, a lot of people. You know, I've looked at the Facebook, something, he'd help you out. Chris has said that, and I agree. But without hesitation, I mean, he didn't even think about it. It just wasn't even an issue. So, Dave Brocky, you miserable fuck. I love you. And, you know, finally I want to say, just something about it. You know, Chris said the other day that other than his own dick, the dick that he's seen more than any other dick, Rocky's dick. And it's a constant presence, dangling like a uvula. And you're always seconds away from seeing Dave's dick. So, oh, dickling, yeah. But, you know, I just want to. I want to say something. Dave Brocky loved the people he played music with. He loved the people in war. He loved y'all. He loved me. He loved all of us. And that, you know, Adam said that, and he's absolutely right. And it's a, you know, it might sound, it doesn't sound strange to anybody who knew him, that he loved and was loyal to all of us. And, you know, and just, before I go, man, on grief, I want my friends to know that I love so much. Let it out. Cry a river of tears. There's not enough tears. Keep crying them. And reach out. Don't let grief get you alone. Okay? I love you all.
I'm going to assume most people know who I am here. Short guy. It's gonna be hard to follow, you know, the luminaries I'm behind, but I'm gonna try and take a different approach and just sum this up pretty quickly. Because you know, I think there's a similar thread through all of these things about meeting Dave at any point in any of our lives where we were impressionable and we needed someone to sort of focus a feeling we had. And so in all these other stories, I'm just another one of those. But, you know, I'm going to be different in the fact that this last week has been so intense as far as trying to come to grips with this and think about him in a larger historical perspective. And that's what I'm going to try to do here. I'm going to try and, like, take what a larger view of Dave, because studying a lot of history and a lot of art. And, you know, a big worry of mine throughout my entire career with this, and I've been involved since I was a little kid, you know, so I've been involved for my entire adult life with this band. So, yeah, you know, it's now it's, I'm aware of that, but it's a burden to think, like, you know, this thing is happening that's so incredible. I just hope that people realize it eventually. And if anything, this week has proved to me that I'm not worried about that. People know who they are, you know, we will be remembered. You know, Dave will be remembered. His legacy is intact. And for that, like, I sleep easy at night. I miss him incredibly, and I don't sleep easy, but I sleep easy in the fact that his legacy is intact, because the outpouring from everyone at every level is so the same. It's incredible. And in that, that's what I'm going to speak of just real briefly. And that's, I've come to view Dave this last week as something that, you know, we all talk about him as the person we knew. And I'm thinking of him in such a bigger terms than that. And he was like an embodiment of an otherworldly force of artistic creativity and youth. And in that respect, everybody that talks about him just said, like, you know, we can't believe he's gone, because they can't believe that this embodiment of of creativity in youth is gone. And you know, how do you eulogize? But that's it. Like, you know, Brocky wasn't gonna get old. Like, because youth and creativity can't get old. He just went away. You know, because he wouldn't be any other way. You know, how do you like the thing about, we all say, oh, he drove me crazy. Dave knew how to do things, but he wouldn't do them. You know, he would say like, well, that's not interesting. I know how to make a mold, I know how to draw, but that's not interesting to me. I'm gonna do it backwards or with some product that I just found in an alley, you know? Because he didn't want it to be the same old thing. He didn't want it to be right or like proper or a craft. He wanted it to be some sort of like, cosmic voyage, you know, through outer space. You know, he wanted it to be some sort of just thing that happened to him, experience. And you know, that was the frustrating thing. So just make the fucking prop. Like, could you please just finish it on time? And I was like, no, because that would be no fun. That would be no fun to finish it on time and on budget. I'm going to, you know, like, find something in an alley and dump some Mod Podge on it and use everything that you're not supposed to use, some straw or something. And I was like, you know, but just like Bishop and just like Bob said, it was like, that was what you got from him. You got like, well, just because that's the way you do it doesn't mean it's the way you have to do it. And if you don't enjoy doing it, do it a different way. Like, just, you know, he just shook it up. And the most frustrating thing about him was the greatest thing about him. And you know, to sum it all up, I'll say, like, it was the most, you know, it is, there's all these, like, jargon slogans about, like, the military, like Bishop said, but it's true. Like, it was the hardest thing that I've ever loved. And it was the most rewarding pain in the ass that I've ever had to deal with.
Didn't write any stand-up routine for this time around. All Hallmark card, fuzzy poster bullshit. So, but it's short. So, appreciate that. We can get to drinking and carousing soon. Yeah, I know you have. Just hold on. Couple more minutes. All right. Ready? I last saw Dave Brocky alive the evening of March 26, 2014. 3 days after he died. I was asleep. Get off of me. I
thought that was our cue to have sex.
Good thing you didn't last long. Alright. So, I was asleep, and I dreamt I was with all the Guar guys, and we were on tour. We were all sitting around in the living room. It was part of this larger loft space. And I was sitting on a large couch facing... I know, it's short, but it's hard to get through. And I was facing a coffee table, and across from the coffee table, several large, soft chairs. It was the kind of party atmosphere that we found ourselves in after a show while we were on tour. And suddenly, one person appeared, or... he became apparent, sitting in a chair across from me. And it was Dave Brocky. and he was smiling and enjoying himself like everyone else. And I blinked. I blinked. I blinked and I rubbed my eyes and he was still there. I said, that's impossible. I can't be seeing this, I thought. I finally turned to a person next to me. I said, are you seeing this? Isn't that Dave Brocky? They nodded. They nodded in agreement with polite indifference, like somebody who's indulging you. And the next person I asked did the same. It was not the kind of confirmation that I was looking for. Finally, I thought, if this is a ghost or a figment of my imagination, then it will not show up on camera. That's right. Vampires don't show up in mirrors. And so, I got out my smartphone to take his picture. And as I opened the menu, I realized I didn't know how to take a picture with his phone. I fumbled madly as I tried to figure out which buttons to push, feeling like a total technophobe. But finally, I was ready. I was ready to take the picture. And when I looked up, he was gone. Three significant comets came by us in the last 30 years. The second one was 1986's Halley's Comet, said to appear in the sky once every 80 or so years. And for some reason, I couldn't be bothered to go outside and look at it, as I was too busy working on this new band I was part of called Guar. So I missed that one. And the third comet was called Hale Bopp, which appeared in 1997. Nike. While it was significant enough for some Nike-wearing eunuchs to commit cult suicide over, it was not significant enough for me to pop my head out of the sled pit and get a good look. So I missed that one too. But the first comet appeared in 1984 in the Biograph Theater as part of a punk rock show, and I have never been the same. It changed everything about me, who I thought I was, to what I did for a living, to whom I would marry and have a child with. I probably won't think too much about those other comets much during my life. But the first one is in my DNA, and I will never forget.
Much can be said of Dave. Well, I look overly for my colleagues. I, of course, would choose to acknowledge him as an accomplished master of his craft, which is image, words, performance art, and music. But all that held that together was his humor. And his humor was so unique, humor has to have the right amount of wrong to be good. And he had so much wrong, this was great. You could make you hold two conflicting ideas, insulted and entertained to the point where your brain was boggled and it became like this optical illusion, linguistic illusion, where you could almost believe in anything. So where did that come from? And amongst some of my esteemed alumni from Robinson High School might know about our formative years in high school, and I could talk about shenanigans and such, but maybe I'm uniquely suited to talk about Dave's home life. And I've feel compelled to do so in honor of you, but mostly of his family, whom I loved. Dave survived his brother, Andrew. Andrew is about 3 or 4 years older. A genuine genius, innate intellect, who reportedly got the second highest SATs in Virginia at that time, without even studying. He just learned, he just absorbed. So his humor was quick and witty, but without puns, but with wordplay and references. Sometimes you like that, but you knew how to laugh. And if you didn't, you challenged yourself to find out that you should. And Dave learned a lot from him. Dave also survived his mother, Miriam, whom I loved. And she fought in the Battle of Britain in World War II as a Women's Air Corps or Auxiliary Corps for the World Air Force. Survived being bombed out in a basement under rubble for 3 or 4 days at a hand's length, hand's touch to another pinned friend who expired in that time. Marianne was able to keep herself alive by sipping from a broken drain pipe, trickling down water, and they finally dug her out. So she gone through so much tragedy in her life, choose to see the better side of life. One of her favorite songs, you know, Monty Python, life's a piece of shit when you look at it, you know, you just gotta look on the bright side. And she whistled that all the time. Sometimes, when she was so stressed by that little devil of his, her son, Dave, she would, so yeah, she's a semi-retired legal secretary, so she had some time, and favorite is she's sitting on, just lying on the sofa watching her favorite show, Star Trek, The Limp Generation, and had this thing for Commander Riker, and up in the DC, on certain channels, it would play 4 or 5 hours a day, and she would watch them on. Sometimes I would be sitting on the floor in front of her, and then Dave and Andrew felt it was their task to keep her entertained somehow. And they would have a witty banter back and forth. Andrew would have witty banter back and forth. But then Dave would just like get in front of the TV. Mommy, look at me, Mommy. Don't you love your son? And she would, so, about that time, Cats was playing for 2 or 3 years or forever up there. Hell, our family even went. And it's like, Mom, Mom, I'm going to serenade you Cats. Memories of a long moonlight. She's like, if you touch me, you'll understand what a penis is. That penis live again. She said, she's like, oh, I thank God you're not my biological son. You are a demon seed. Go, get out of here. Get away from him. Get out of my sight. So we ran off into the woods and got high by University of But the thing about this humor, and it bounced between those two dynamics, was that it was always infectious, like a good STD. It was about 2 or 3 days later, he had me, Andrew, and Miriam singing that. Practically rolling on the floor. It was always fun. Almost in harmony, too. And I guess we've all been kind of affected by that. So, I guess in closing, I've got 2 things. He always considered me his Spock. And he was my Kirk. So, him coming down Bear with me. In all my travels, of all the twisted, mischievous souls I've encountered, his was the most human. All right, Shatter did better. If you got them, raise them in honor of our ascended and transcended artistic warrior brethren. I am honored. Thank you.
Lived together for the last 3 years, and I just want to express how grateful and how fortunate I am, and we are, to have had that personal connection with him every day. You know, I saw him every day. I saw his dick every day. And I saw his inside feelings, and, you know, we were always there for him, and he was there for us. And he told us that we were his family, and he always saw something in me that I would have never seen. And I think he saw that in everybody, you know. And he would make sure that it would come out. And I'm just very lucky. We're all very lucky to have known him. And I'm gonna miss him.
I'm gonna keep this really short because Dave would have been bored out of his mind by this point. This is a room full of people that Dave Brocky loved. This was a gathering of people that love Dave Brocky. I don't know if there's a room in the world that could hold us all. But I know that he touched everyone in this room, usually in very, very inappropriate ways. I apologize for that. But something tonight has shown us all that everyone has their favorite Brocky story, and I'm going to spare you and not tell another one, but each one's more ridiculous and outlandish than the one before, and I would have found it impossible to believe them all if I hadn't been there to witness so many of his exploits firsthand. And I hope we can all get together after this and continue to share stories, because Brocky would want us to laugh at his outrageousness and his stupidity and his absolute genius. Seeing Dave through other people's eyes remind me that he was more than my friend. He was more than my bandmate. He was more than my brother, my leader, and my inspiration. Dave was a true folk hero. Dave Brocky was larger than life, and life seems smaller without him. Love you, Dave.
To bring the official end to this memorial, it is my suggestion. Usually they do a moment of silence, and that just seems so, so horribly wrong. No, I won't. We're going to end this now, and I encourage you to speak and engage with everybody here, but to end this instead of a moment of silence, like Adrian, we will and that is make noise. The fitting, the man, the legend, our friend, our comrade, David Brocky. On the count of three, scream!